In this video, we're going to talk about ways to visualize sets of data. So let's say we have some big set of data and it looks like this. Well, just looking at this set of data, it might be difficult to see any kind of trends or do any kind of analysis on it. But we can organize this data, let's say, into a frequency distribution table. In this frequency distribution table, we have several classes. In this particular table, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 classes. And this table quickly tells you how many times our data points fall into each one of these classes. For example, we have 1, 2, 3, 4 pieces of data that fall in between the values of 8 and 13, so we have a number 4 right here. We have 1, 2 pieces of data that fall into the class from 20 to 25, so we have a number 2 right here. And we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 pieces of data that fall between 32 and 37, so we have a number 8 right here. So this data is pretty nicely organized by this table. Now just a couple of definitions. Each one of these classes has a smallest value, and that's called a lower class limit. And each one of these classes has a highest value called an upper class limit. Let's answer some questions. First, let's find the total number of observations. Well, we could go over here and look at the original set of data and count how many observations we have here, how many numbers we have here. Or we could just as easily add up all of the frequencies in this table to get the same number. We have a frequency of 4, 2, and 8. If we add those three numbers together, I'm getting a total of 14 observations. If we want to find the class width, it might be tempting to just subtract 13 minus 8. However, that would be incorrect. To find the class width, we actually subtract two upper class limits that are right next to each other or two lower class limits that are right next to each other. For example, if we look at these two lower class limits, we can subtract 14 minus 8, and that gives us our class width. Next, we want to find the midpoint of the third class, and things are about to get pretty messy, so I'm going to erase all this stuff. The third class is this one right here, and if we want to find the midpoint of that class, we can take the lower class limit plus the upper class limit and divide by 2. In other words, we can find an average of the upper and lower class limits. When I do that, I'm getting 22.5. The next question asks us to find the modal class, and the modal class is the class that has the highest frequency. So the highest frequency you can see is right here at 8. That means that the modal class is going to be 32 to 37. And finally, if we wanted to add one more class to the end of this frequency distribution table, what would be the class limits? Well, to answer that question, maybe I should give you a couple of rules. The first rule is that all classes in a frequency distribution table should have the same width. You'll notice that that is the case up here with this table. Going from 8 to 14 is a difference of 6. Going from 14 to 20 is a difference of 6. From 20 to 26, and so on. So all of our classes have the same width. The second rule is that classes should not overlap. And you can see that that is also the case in this table. The first class ends at 13 and the second class starts at 14. The second class ends at 19 and the third class starts at 20. So you'll notice that there is no overlap here. Now, okay, to answer this question, we want to put a class right here at the end of this table. Since our previous class ended at 43, our new class should start at 44, and there are lots of ways to find the upper class limit here, but I'll just observe that to get every one of these upper class limits, we can just add 5 to the lower class limit. So if we add 5 to 44, we get 49. Okay, so I think that that answers all of the questions here. Let's move on to the next problem. Here we have a bunch of data given to us. Let's quickly construct a frequency distribution. Taking a quick look at our data, we have values from 0 to 10. So I'm going to try to squeeze all of those values into this table. And in the frequency column, we're just going to write down how many times each one of those values appears. So the value 0 appears in our data twice. So we're going to put a 2 here for our frequency. The value 1 appears 4 times. The value 2 appears 5 times, the value 3 appears 4 times, and so on until we finish this table up. The next question asks us to construct a histogram for the data, and a histogram looks like a bar graph. On the horizontal or x-axis, we have the value, and on the vertical or y-axis, we have the frequency. Okay, so I'm going to put our values of 1 to 10 on the horizontal axis. And taking a quick look at our frequencies, it looks like they go from 1 to 6. So I'm going to put that on our vertical axis. Now for each value, we're going to mark our frequency down on this table. I'm going to put a dot right here because for the value 0, our frequency is 2. For the value 1, our frequency is 4. For the value 2, our frequency turned out to be 5. And I'm going to continue this graph trying to keep things lined up here. Now there we go, we have all of our dots here. Now what we do with those dots depends on the kind of graph that we're trying to make. If we're making a histogram, then what we do is we make a little bar for each one of those dots. So our histogram is going to end up looking something like this. And you can judge my artistic abilities at home. I'd say that this is a lovely histogram. There you go, that's what it looks like for this data. Now, if instead of a histogram, we wanted to construct a frequency polygon for our data, what we would do is just take those dots that we made and connect them with straight lines. Then once we've done that, typically we take the leftmost point and connect it back to the x-axis, and take the rightmost point and connect that back to the x-axis as well. Then that stuff in orange would create your frequency polygon. Okay, let's look at the next example. Here's some data for you, and you are given the first class in your frequency distribution and asked to complete the table. So your first class is all values between 472 and 492. So what I'm going to do is go up to this data and cross off all of the values from 472 to 492. I see one there. Hopefully I'm not missing anything, but I see six data values there. So I'm going to put a six as our frequency. And we need to create the next class. So remember, our class width should all be the same, and we should have no overlap between our classes. So if our previous class ends at 492, our next class should start at 493. And since the difference between the lower class limit and the upper class limit was 20, I know that my upper class limit here should be 513. I got that 513 by adding 20 to 493. Now I'm going to go up to my data and cross off all of the values from 493 to 513. Again, I hope I'm not missing anything, but I see 6 again. Let's go on to our next class. It should start at 514 because that's one bigger than 513, and it should go all the way up to 534. Because that number is 20 bigger than 514. Now let's cross off all of our data values between 514 and 534. I see 4 values there. Moving on to our next class, we should start at 535 and go all the way up to 555. I am counting 6 data values in that range. Our next class would go from 556 all the way up to 576. Crossing off all of those data values, I'm getting a total of 4. And for what hopefully is our last class, because I'm running out of room, we're going from 577 to 597. And I'm seeing 1, 2, 3, 4 data points there. A really quick check to see if we've caught everything. If we add all of our frequencies together, I am getting a total of 30 data points. And if we look up at our original data, we did have 30 data points to start. So good, I am pretty happy with that. Let's construct a histogram for this data. Now our histogram is going to look similar to before. On the horizontal axis, we're going to have our classes or our scores. And you'll notice that we have 6 classes, so I have 6 tick marks here. On the vertical axis, we're going to have our frequency or our number. And you'll notice that our highest frequency is 6. Now on our horizontal axis, for each one of these classes, what we're going to do is we're going to put the midpoint as our value for each one of these ticks. So as an example, for our first class, we have 472. To 492. The midpoint is 472 plus 492 divided by 2. That gives us 482 is our midpoint of that class. So that number is going to go right here. Calculating the midpoint of all of our other classes gives us all of these numbers. And now we can draw our histogram in using the frequency as the height of each of these bars. What I lack in artistic ability, I can try to compensate for with some colors. There we go. That histogram looks pretty good. So let's move on to the next problem. We're going to construct a stem and leaf plot. We're going to have a bunch of stems that go in here and a bunch of leaves that go in here. And I'll start writing these values in, and hopefully it will be somewhat self-explanatory. For this data up here, I'm going to have stems of 0 through 4. Those represent the first digits of each one of these data values. So we think of 5 as 0, 5, and 7 as 0, 7, all the way up to 41. For our leaves, we're going to have the final digit of each one of these numbers. So for the two data points that have a stem of 0, our leaves are 5 and 7. It looks like we have 5 data points with stems of 1. Our leaves there are going to be 2, 3, 5, 7, and 8. We have 5 data points with a stem of 2, and our leaves are going to be 0, 1, 3, 3, and 7. We have 3 data values with stems of 3, and our leaves are going to be 1, 2, and 4. And we have 1 last data value with a stem of 4, that has a leaf of 1. Okay, I hope that that makes sense to you and is pretty straightforward. Let's take a look at this last problem that involves a circle chart, also known as a pie graph. We're told that the cost to attend a public university is just under $16,000 here. The circle graph here shows how to break down that just under $16,000. For example, 42.3% of that $15,936 goes to tuition and fees. If we want to determine how much money that is in dollars for tuition and fees, we can convert this 42.3% to 0.423. We just change that percent into a decimal. Then what we can do is we can multiply that by the 15,936. Rounding then to two decimal places tells us that 42.3% of the total number, 15,936, turns out to be $6,740.93. That's how much a student is spending on tuition and fees. We could continue this for room and board, 30.6%. We can convert that to 0.306. We can multiply that by the total amount of money, and we can round to two decimal places and get that $8,876.42 is spent on room. And okay, I'm going to trust that you can continue that process for the rest of the problem. And I'll stop this video right here, and I will see you all in the next one.